Hello, I'm Bob Matheny, Mayor of Zebulon, and guess what? This is the Zebulon Mayor's Show. We've had a lot going on here lately, and I've been in the news, and I kind of wanted to explain to those that perhaps don't know, and then some perhaps have some questions, what has happened. Our town manager of 15 years, Rick Harden, submitted his resignation to us after he received his second DWI. Now, when he got his first, we forgave him and said, well, everybody makes a mistake. But the second time around, there really was not much choice. We felt like send the wrong signal to the community and the public in general. So we did accept his resignation, which became effective November the 7th. Now, he was eligible or is eligible for retirement according to the state retirement system and according to our town policy. So he can draw those retirements and go ahead and as I say, retire. So you know, he's not totally left out in the cold, and we certainly are very sorry that it happened. We wish Rick well, but the town needs to move on. So that's exactly, you know, what we've done. We have actually appointed an interim manager to fill the position until such time as we can find a permanent manager, and we've already begun that process. We met just this week with a representative, an HR person, from the North Carolina League of Municipalities, and he gave us some guidelines as to how they thought best to pursue acquiring a new manager, and a full outline of all the steps of the procedure. So we're gearing up for that. We think that it's probably going to take anywhere from 4 to 6 months to complete the process. We just don't know. It depends on the applicants that we get, their qualifications, whether we think they're a good fit for Zebulon and this board or not. So, you know, we just have to work at it. We've been there before. Three of our board members were actually involved with the town of Zebulon when we hired Mr. Harden 15 years ago. So have been through that process. The others, as I say again, we're educated along with the rest of us again on procedures. So kind of rambling a little bit here, but I wanted you to understand what happened, why it happened, and the process that we're going to go through to find a new town manager. And I'll try to keep you updated as we go through the next several months. I'll try to tell you where we are in that process. Well, what we did was we needed someone to be an interim town manager. You may or may not be aware that we are a council manager form of government, which means that we have to have a manager to manage the departments and the employees of the town. That person is totally responsible for that and responsible to the Board of Commissioners. And someone from Board of Commissioners is really not eligible to be the town manager and sit on the board at the same time. So we were fortunate to find an employee, a former employee that had been with us for many, many years, and I want to ask him to come over now and introduce you again to Sidney Perry. Sidney is our interim town manager. When you retired, you were our fire chief. You were our fire chief. Tell us a little bit, and first of all, welcome. You know that I'm very pleased that you decided to help us out, the whole board, and I think the town as well. Tell us a little bit about your history with the town. I know you were with us for like 45 years. You were.
Yes, sir. I was. I joined the town in 1967, back when Willie B. Hopkins was the man of the hour here, and started then. And right after I started, I was with the Public Works Department, and then at that time they asked the members of the town employees to be a fireman, so I joined the fire department just a little after that. So I became a member of the fire department along with working with the Public Works Department. And then as years went on, we had an auxiliary police force, and so I was asked to join that, and me and seven others joined that and went to Wake Tech and got our training. So I worked for about 10 years as an auxiliary policeman with the police department, so I had the opportunity to get my hands into the police department some and enjoyed that. I enjoyed the public works. And of course, with the fire department, I served for 25 years as a volunteer, and then I was hired as the full-time chief, which gave me my 45 years altogether. So I've had the opportunity to work in Zebulon and those different areas, and so hopefully doing that and understanding, you know, intricately what each one does, hopefully I'll be an asset to you and the board as we fill this gap while you're looking for your new manager.
And I'm sure you will, and again, we very much appreciate it. I think for a time you were also public safety director.
Yes, sir. There was a time when we had a police chief that left, and we had no one there at that point, and so I was asked to look after both the police and fire department. So I did that. I think it lasted a little over a year while they were searching for a police chief, but I did do that and enjoy that. I just enjoyed serving the town. I enjoy what Zebulon means and working with citizens and helping people out, I guess, and that's why I probably said yes to you when you called. Is one reason why, and so that's how I got there.
Well, again, I know you answered the call, and I know you have great affection for the town, as we all do, and I just can't say it enough how much we appreciate the fact that you're here. For the sake of people knowing, you're going to work an average of 24 hours a week, three days a week, which is very typical for an interim manager not to be here full time. I mean, if a lot of times interim managers had travel a great distance to get here just to help manage during that period. In your case, you probably travel a couple of miles.
Right, that's true.
But the point being is that you're not going to be here full time. So if someone really needed to see you, they should probably call ahead and be
here. Yeah, please call me and I'll make arrangements to meet with me. Yes, sir.
Right, okay. All right. Well, again, I appreciate what you're doing. We hope to have this wrapped up in 4 to 6 months. It's probably going to be closer to six than four, as I know you've heard from our person that we've met with from the league. But we're going to move and try to get you back to be the retired person that you want to be as quickly as possible.
That'll be fine.
But you know, when you came on board, you inherited a lot of projects that are going on, and I thought maybe you and I would just talk about some of these projects and inform the people of what's going on. I get questions on the street all the time, and I know, you know, if you haven't, you will.
I have, you know. Once you're an employee of the town, if they know you've been an employee, you know, people, citizens will ask you questions. You know, it doesn't matter who you are, and I still get them. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Well, let's start with a project that has been snake bit because it's been on again and off again and on again and off again, having to do with engineering, DOT, bridge requirements, Shepherd School road project. Talk about that just a little bit.
Okay, that is finally underway. Like, as you said, there's been some off and on going on with there, but that project is finally underway. As you may recall, we're trying to get a sidewalk from the Boys and Girls Club back to the schoolhouse, the Zebulon Middle School. And so funds have finally been appropriated to go from Zebulon, from the Boys and Girls Club across the bridge, and then it'll stop in its first phase there. And then hopefully next year, if we can get the funding, we got our name in the pot, we can finish that. But that's planned to be finished in January of next year, 2015. Okay. And that was, I think, about a $325,000 project is what kind of money we're talking about. But that's for, you know, accessibility for our people walking, pedestrians in a safe manner to get to that Boys and Girls Club, which is, you know, as you know, used very heavily and a fine, you know, place to go for our children.
Well, that was originally a single-phase project. I mean, it was supposed, the whole project was supposed to be done, and it just, we couldn't make it fit the budget, and we just simply didn't have the money. So we figured, okay, we'll get as much done as we can. We broke it into two phases and used the money available to get the part that's being done now. Mm-hmm. So, as you said, we're still pursuing it. For those that are going to say, why did they stop there? We just ran out of money, and we're doing the best we can, but we're going back and try to get the rest of it, which I think is another 80 to 100,000, somewhere along in there, to get that done. I really think it's closer to 80, but it'll have to be rebid. That part will have to be bid. The good news is that the most dangerous part of the walk is going to be done.
Be taken care of.
The shoulder where we're not doing it is very wide, where people can walk much more safely. Probably as safe as you could with a sidewalk, but we still want to get the sidewalk. But the other part got kind of tight from the north end. It pushed people out towards the road, and a lot more hazardous there. Well, we'll keep our fingers crossed.
Hopefully.
All right, well, you know, we were fortunate enough to receive a Rex endowment, and might want to talk about that just a little bit.
Yes, this is a Greenway project that has been talked about for really a number of years. And you may remember, Mayor, I was looking back over some information back in 97. We looked at a Greenway. I don't know whether you remember that or not, but it got looked at and didn't go too far. But now we've received, I think it's a three-year grant, I believe, from the John Rex Endowment. I think this one is about $68,000 totally, but we're hoping that the board will award a bid this coming meeting that we have to start the process of the Greenway plan. And there will be all kinds of publicity on this project. We want all of our citizens and all to be aware of what we're doing, what a Greenway means, how they can use it, all the advantages of having a Greenway, and there will be all kinds of brochures. You'll see all kinds of information out there. I'm sure at some point in time you'll probably have a show maybe even that really gets specific, so we won't get into that now. But this project is hopefully getting ready to begin in just a few weeks once it's approved by the board. The paperwork and all will begin, and then we hope that this is a long project. We're talking about years down the road. We get things going, and then you'll add to it just continually. You've got a project in there that I think I'd love to see. You know, I like the rivers, and we're talking about the Blueway, from the park on 97 down to Tarpley's Mill, what we call Tarpley's Mill. Hopefully someday that will be a part of it. So there's a lot of good stuff that we hope is coming down in regarding this Greenway project that we're getting ready to activate, hopefully.
Well, Greenways are not only good for connectivity, they're good for exercise and just add to the ambiance of the community.
Yes, sir.
We think that's real important. There's another piece to that Rex Endowment, though, and that's Farmers Market that'll be coming up. And we'll have more information on that later on. Right now, it is an integral part of that Rex Endowment. Mm-hmm. So we'll be looking to open a farmer's market in the spring. Location is still kind of up in the air, trying to figure out the best place to put that. But again, that Rex Endowment was encompassing both of those projects. And to be specific with the Greenway, what we're looking at is a Greenway study. Mm-hmm. With that in hand, then we're able to go after grants because we have everything done. We say, here's what we want to do. The engineers or the planners or the consultants or whatever have put the good housekeeping seal of approval on it.
So, yes, sir.
But in any event, as you said, it is the early stages of the Greenway. But you got to have to start somewhere.
Yes, sir.
So that's it. UDO, Unified Development Ordinance. We've been working on that for a while, so you might.
Yes, our planning department, this is where they really zero in on. But it's a part that sometimes our citizens don't like. But, it's our rules and our regulation, that governs our development. And we have to have an orderly manner of doing it and a proper way to do it. And we've got to meet state and federal regulations. And so it's time to upgrade, I guess is a word I'll say that we'll use, and you can expand on it. You know, these ordinances, we're trying to get in line with that, with this UDO.
Well, what it does too is takes out any conflicting statements within the planning documents, so that if over here it says you can do this and over here it says you can't or you have to do it differently, it goes through and sweeps all that up. It's kind of like a recodification of the ordinances. So, it really The idea is to make it much simpler for developers, one-stop shopping, if you will, for the information that they need. And it's way past due. I think, I'm afraid to say 20 years, but it's been 15 years or so since it's been done. So it's way past its time. And then, of course, speaking of developers, we've got some development coming on now that I'm sure that they would have appreciated having a UDO when they came in, and hopefully the future developers will. But things are picking back up, so let's talk just a little bit about what's going on. Subdivisions, for example.
Yeah, they are. It's great. I rode around with our Public Works Director the other day, and we went to all the subdivision, and it's great to go ride through the subdivision and seeing houses going up. Yeah. You know, we got Weaver's Pond building a number of houses. We got Braemar just about built out. They got a few more in there, but we've got Tarrant Meadows that is starting to build out and got a number of houses started. We got Shepherd's Point, which is a very nice subdivision that has brick homes in it, a little upper scale, that is working and building out good. We've got some other subdivisions that we hope is coming online, and you might mention that in a few minutes with the Beaver Dam project. Get that online, and we can hook up to some more subdivisions. So things are looking good for Zebulon in regard to the subdivisions. We're getting houses on the ground. And there's some sold signs out there. They're not just building them, but a lot of them are already sold. So it's looking great for us.
Yeah, it is. It's really good. And a lot of these, I'll say a lot of them, but several of them are only in the first phase of construction. Mm-hmm. So there's subsequent phases. I think we're somewhere in the neighborhood of between 2,000, 2,500 homes when all of these subdivisions build out. You know, don't hold me to that number. Trying to recall, you know, without having gone back and looked it up.
That's probably close, because I know Weaver's Pond is about 700 in close itself
close to 700. So, Shepherd's Point, which is dormant right now, but looks like it might pick back up. I think that's somewhere in the 400 maybe.
Shepherd's Park.
Shepherd's Point was 40-something.
Yes, sir.
But anyway, in any event, at least they're building again. And then we also have this monster building going up. So people still ask, what's going on up there?
That question all the time. I can go in any store, you know, and especially now that they know, I say, what in the world is that building on the corner of Green Pace and Arundel Avenue? You know, and we're certainly proud to say, hey, that's the BB&T data center, you know, what I call it. But that's certainly a fine addition to Zebulon. That's I think roughly a $90 million project that's going on right now. And as we've talked earlier, this is just the first phase of what they may do out there. They're building a large, enormous building out there. And again, when you think about a $90 million building, that's good news to us, you know, with our tax base and what we've had to deal with in the recession and the whole harmless money being gone. You know, projects like this really help us to catch our breath and get started back again.
Well, and, you know, Anthony Creech built his animal hospital out there. Wendy's is still on again, off
still
again.
On,
They've gone through the TRC, which is Technical Review Committee, to make sure that their development meets all of our ordinance criteria. But my understanding is that Marathon Oil purchased Wilco Hess, and so during that transition, it may have slowed down a little bit. But I think it's still on go. I get asked about that a lot.
Right, exactly.
Very briefly, Glaxo and Nomaco, Nomacork.
Some people know, you know, Nomaco has bought the little shop, the Triangle East, I believe they've named it now, down there, and they're building some buildings, you know, for lease, and so that's good, again, to see the metal and the steel go up down there. GSK, we understand, are looking at adding a couple of renovations out there. It's in the early phases, so I won't speak specifically, but they are looking at increasing their square footage out there in the near future, adding on for some growth out there also. Yes, sir.
And East Wake Academy, I think, is looking at another expansion.
East Wake Academy is growing. They are getting rid of some of the last trailers they have out there, but they're also growing, and so they need a bigger building. And they're building about a 23,000 square foot building out there. Now, I know we don't get taxes from that, but we get people coming in, and that's money in a way for us.
Right.
thing about taxes, that people come in and buy something to eat, they buy fuel, you know, do things like that. Plus, it brings people in for other reasons. Contractors come in and build the building, so it is a help, and it shows that we're growing if they need another building out there, and that's a...
Yeah, it's an economic stimulus.
Yes, sir, exactly. So we're glad to hear about that.
Well, you mentioned Beaver Dam Outfall. I'll explain that. I'll run that rabbit just for a minute. Beaver Dam Outfall is a new sewer collection line that will run from up around Weaver's Pond, north of town, north up 96, and it will go through, heading east, down through the bottom, all the way and cross 64 Highway with a lift station there. And then it will pump back across the hill on the east side of Walmart, somewhere back along there, and tie into the current lines that feed the waste treatment plant. That's going to open up a tremendous amount of acreage because I know you're aware water's pretty easy because you have the water tank. It pushes the water, so it'll go uphill, downhill, and around the corner. Mm-hmm. Sewer doesn't work that way. It for the most part, you want it to be as much gravity as it can be, and then you put in a lift station. So what this would do is take two lift stations, lift or pump stations, offline and consolidate those into one, and which will be a lot more efficient. It'll open up a terrific amount of potential land for development. It may not happen tomorrow, but maybe the day after or the next. And then it'll also take a lot of pressure on what we call the Northern Interceptor, which runs up north of Rendell. And that's just about running at capacity, so anything else that wanted to build up that way needs to be able to send their waste down the Northern Interceptor. So it opens land on both sides because of the taking pressure off the interceptor and then opening up all this other that can be gravity sewered. So that project is not our project per se. It is run by the City of Raleigh. Because we're merged, as I know you know, but I'm saying it for the folks that are listening, we are merged with Raleigh Utilities, and they provide the utility service, water and sewer, down here. So they're the ones that are running that rabbit, but we're the beneficiary.
We're going to benefit from it.
Well, we have a couple of other things. One is, you know, we have the North Arundel plan starting up, just the north side of the 64, running on up to Raleigh Hill Road,
I believe it is.
You want to talk about that a little bit, or you want me to run it?
Well, if you want to share with them, either way, you know, you a lot's been done there already, but we've got a lot to do. You know, we've got the sheets, and we've got the Bojangles, and we've got some other places, and of course, the BB&T building we talked about, and all that corridor up through there is in for change.
Right.
There's going to be widening of roads and different things happening up there and opening up to more business and, as you say, get more water and sewer and we can get more industry up there. It even has gone a little farther. You know, I think the Dollar General has gone beyond that a little bit,
right.
But that shows that there's growth going out that way. And so we've got that on the radar, and we've got talking about that, and that's something that's going to happen probably, you know, in the near future instead of maybe way down the road.
Well, we're actually looking at that. The last date I heard was start construction 2017.
Okay.
The engineering still has to be done, but in fact, the engineering is fixing to be done.
Mm-hmm.
But it would four-lane that and median with sidewalks and maybe bike lanes going north, north-south there. And also, it'll clean up that intersection at Pierce's Road where Sheets is. And right now, when you come down, you only have one turn lane to the left and one to the right. Now, what you'll eventually have is two to the left, so you can make that parallel turn and one to the right. So it'll open up and take a lot of pressure off of that intersection. That one is really in the hopper.
We're
moving.
Hopefully on the way.
We're moving on that. And speaking of hoppers, we'll talk about an asphalt hopper. I get a lot of questions about, when are you going to do anything about downtown?
Yes, sir.
People need to understand before you get and give us the good news. People understand that we have city and town streets, and we have DOT streets. And that is a DOT street, as is East Judd Street is a DOT. So, and East Horton. So there's a lot of streets that people might not realize that, that they are the responsibility of the Department of Transportation and not necessarily the town. That's our town, so we have to speak for them. But let's give the good news about downtown.
And, it's ironic that we talk about this because I was at church this Sunday, and of course people have heard that I was going to fill in here. And so one of our citizens said, "Hey, you're the new manager. How about getting that spot in front of Dedham's Hardware paved while you're the manager?"
Yeah, yeah.
And what's going to be good about it next Sunday when I go to church, I'm going to tell him I'm going to get it
done. You took care of it.
I took care of it, taking all the glory and have none at all.
I don't blame you.
But of course, the State Department of Transportation has given us a schedule for that area. And so it is supposed to be milled and repaved from Gannon Avenue down to the railroad track sometime between mid-March and mid-April of next year.
Right.
So it's coming. Just give us 2 or 3 months. Of course, the weather, you know, may affect it a little bit. But hopefully sometime between March and April of next year, that those three blocks, really, you're looking at 100, 200, and 300 block, and a little bit down to the railroad track, all that will be remilled and repaved and smoothed out.
Right.
And again, this is a state project, so as you said, we don't have control over telling the state when they're going to do streets. You know,
right.
We do have some over ours. Of course, it's done by severity of need. But this one is finally getting paved, and you and I both have, you know, heard it many, many times. When in the world are y'all going to pave that street?
Right.
So
right.
It's coming. If they can just wait just a few more months. I think the Fred Smith Company, most folks know them, a large contracting company, has been awarded the bid to do that from the state. So we look forward to that getting done.
Well, very briefly, Yates Place has a drainage problem that's also to be done. Mm-hmm. That's in this year's budget.
Yes, sir.
And it's going to enlarge the spillways, if you will, on the northern end, which will take the water out quicker. And if that doesn't resolve the problem, then we'll have to go into phase two, which are our collection basins up the street. But we're thinking that at least it'll move the water out quickly at this point. So that's going to be done. Last but certainly not least, something near and dear to my heart, a Citizens Academy.
Mm-hmm.
So let's just touch on that. There'll be a lot more information coming. But
yes, sir. This is something we're going to do. We're probably going to do it the first of the year. Is offer any and all of our citizens. We'll advertise it heavily so you can contact us, and we'll give you the information to do that. And then we'll schedule it to have you to come up here to the town hall. You may end up going to some of the other facilities we have and have a six or eight week program. And we'll share with you interesting topics that we think you may be interested in knowing about the town. Each one of our department heads or the mayor and me and the board, some board members, will share with you what's going on with the town and information about each department, just to hopefully educate you and give you as a citizen the opportunity to ask us about individual departments. So we're looking forward to that. We hope we have 20 or 30 people, we hope. If we have to, we'll keep scheduling it. And we hope we have to keep scheduling it every quarter or whatever is need, what need may be. But we're really looking forward to offering this information to our citizens and hope that they will respond.
Yeah, this would be anywhere from a 6 to 8 week program, hour to hour and a half per session.
Mm-hmm.
And so, again, we would do maybe public works this week, police this week,
mm-hmm.
finance this week, and just kind of move through all the departments and really educate people about the delivery of government and services and what their money goes for and what things cost.
Yes, sir.
You know, what it takes to run this business of the town.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I hope we get a lot of interest in that.
I hope we do.
We'll see. I know it has been a successful program in some other communities.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're looking at what they did as well to help design our program. Well, Sidney, that we're about out of time. That runs the rabbit for us, and I want to again thank you for being here today. I want to thank you for accepting the responsibility of helping us through this time, and I want to thank the folks out there for watching. I hope you found this information useful, and we'll see you next month.